and welcome to this episode of Cardinal Film Fights. As always, I'm your judge and moderator, Mark Rollins, and I'm going to go ahead and say, if you came here for a certain fight, click in the description below. Today, we welcome Jacob, Haley, and Skylar. Before we learn more about them, let's always give a shout out to our fact checker, Von Storm, and our time and scorekeeper, Paige, over there. So, just to give you a rundown of the format, there are four questions, which I have put in random order. So, scoring is based on ranking. Whoever gets first place gets 3 points, whoever gets second place gets 2 points, and whoever gets third place gets 1 point. This is broken up into three segments. You got a 60-second intro where you kind of introduce your choice and why you picked it. You got a 5-minute forum where you go at each other's throats, try to remain on top so that you get first place and not second or third. And then that's followed by a 30-second conclusion where you kind of sum up your entire argument into 30 seconds. So, with that being said, let's jump right into it today, shall we? We're going to start with, let's introduce yourselves. It's not all about me. I like to think it is, but it's not. So we'll go down the line. Haley, just give us your name, your major, and what year you are.
Okay, I am Haley Parnell. I am a freshman TCOM major and women and gender studies minor.
And I'm Jake Peterson. I'm coming off of a victory last season. I'm going to get a victory here today. I am a senior business administration major with a minor in economics and political science. And yeah, that's me.
I'm Skyler Wilson here. I just ate my steak when I got here. I'm a junior telecommunications major, military science minor, and I'm here to kick some ass.
Ooh, wow.
We're already swearing.
Hey, that always means it's going to be a fun fight. So without further ado, well, I just want to say that it sounds like military business and business, I'm sorry, what was business?
Administration.
Administration. Sounds like you guys could help each other, like you can network, like a cartoon network. How's that for a segue, huh?
Wow.
Like, yeah.
So, good.
First question is going to be best cartoon network show. So we'll go right down the line again. Haley, we'll start our minute intros now.
All right. I decided to choose the captivating sitcom Regular Show. Airing in 2009 to just recently saying farewell with its final season, Regular Show is a hilarious adventure that anyone can find joy in. The insane journeys Blue Jay Mordecai and Raccoon Rigby take part in are enthralling because of their wonderful character dynamic, and the show was good enough to even win a primetime Emmy. And let's not forget the wonderful voice actor that adds to the show even more, Mark Hamill, if you're uneducated, Luke Skywalker. Whether you're laughing at the kid-friendly humor or giggling at the small innuendos it has to offer, Regular Show should be recognized as the best Cartoon Network show.
Ooh, very compelling argument. Okay, we'll go down to Jake Peterson now.
I chose Powerpuff Girls, and I'm talking about the original Powerpuff Girls, not the reboot, if that clarifies anything, for three reasons. Number one, it empowered a new generation of young women, capulating female superheroes. You don't have to be sexy. You don't have to be, you know, a sex symbol. You could be a woman and be powerful with that as a superhero. It allowed girls to still be, it's okay to be a girl, but still is empowered by that. And I think it paved the way for a new era of female superheroes like we have today, Wonder Woman and Katniss from Hunger Games. And I think that new era can be attributed to the Powerpuff Girls of my time. So that's why I think Powerpuff Girls. Ooh.
Another compelling argument. And we'll finish off with Skylar.
All right, so what I picked here was the Teen Titans from 2003, the great, amazing series, and I would say by far the best cartoon series that has to date. Reason why I'm saying that is because Teen Titans like dealt with more mature themes while still having that comedy side where younger kids and young adults can still enjoy. There was five characters in the show, which if you watch the show, you can possibly relate to one of them. Each season has like deals with a different theme, deals with sacrifice, betrayal, self-identity, and purpose. All these mature stuff, and that most cartoon shows won't even deal with anymore. And that is why I'm saying Teen Titans, the 2003 version, is the best cartoon series on Cartoon Network.
Ooh, this is going to be a fun 5-minute forum. And without further ado, let's get it going.
The regular show is complete garbage.
Oh,
I don't know if you've watched it. I tried watching it. It's garbage. I mean, the dialogue is there dialogue? Is the question we have bad dialogue, and then we have horrible quality animation. I mean, as far as the animation quality of the people compared to our shows. Which that's the only compliment I'll give. I mean, it's garbage.
Okay.
Have you watched it? It's weird.
I have watched it. I have watched every episode, and it is creatively weird. And I completely disagree with
Pick
you.
Pick Foster's Home for Imaginary Kids if you want weird, or pick. Adventure Time. Pick something better than the regular show, okay. Please. My God, the regular show's terrible.
So
that's enough. So I want to move over here to the Teen Titans. Teen Titans, teenage versions of crappy superheroes together in kind of a gothic, emotional cartoon.
Okay.
That's what Teen Titans really is. You take Robin, not even Batman, Robin. We take Cyborg, this is the only one that's kind of, you know, has some grit to him.
Cyborg, Beast Boy, Starfire, Raven. Raven, who has a traumatic past of a father.
But then
who
we have
really
an over-sexualized, teenage character.
You want to talk about over-sexualized here? You want to talk about the mayor's assistant here? You want to talk about that
Ooh,
here?
She, that is
now,
true.
You don't see her face all the time. I mean, look at the curves right
Ooh.
There.
Yeah.
You've got curves right here.
Well, I know, but she's not half naked and talking about her problems.
But look at that tight skirt, I tell you, right there, okay?
The thing is,
if you, okay, I'll be honest with your kids.
To be empowering
if you're
too focused. Focused on this mayor's assistant.
I'm focusing
and
on
you,
the three
and no, you're
main
focusing
characters.
On the curves.
I'm focusing on the three main characters, okay? And those three characters were allowed to still have their girl roots with it's okay to be funny, and it's okay to wear makeup, it's okay to do those things, and then have the superpowers to go out and fight crime. Where we have regular superheroes, which are either men, strong men, or very sexualized females, and now we have an era that has paved the way for more strong female character superheroes, which I think got its roots with an empowering show like Powerpuff Girls.
So what you're saying is basically it's all about the looks rather than the personalities here.
No, I'm talking about
look, here's the thing. Raven here, who is like you probably, well, one of the most sexualized characters of the show, actually has a traumatic past, which some people can relate to. A father who like doesn't appreciate her, and she trying to resent that. You also have Starfire here, who, if you looked at it this way, she's an immigrant basically, and she's trying to find her place in the world here. If you look at the sexual side of stuff to it, but yet you don't focus on the true grit of it. Starfire is alone in the world where she doesn't feel like she's belonging. That she's an illegal immigrant, and during the origin series, we see that she's not on the same page with them. As a matter of fact, she destroys so much
shit
here.
Let's talk about the longevity.
I'm going to interrupt, actually. I want to hear Haley's response to the attacks against the regular show.
Okay, well, I'm just going to throw this out here, but I did mention that regular show did get one Primetime Emmy, and it did get many more awards, 7 awards to be precise, and 21 nominations, next to looking at all of your guys's, a lot more than your guys's.
Okay.
And
I'm jump on this really quickly.
Mark Hamill is one of the voices on the show. He thinks that it is good enough to be part of it. And
he's
I know.
Getting a paycheck for it.
Yeah, you also
got
Ron.
Work,
you got
a paycheck for it. That's
okay.
All it is.
You got Ron Perlman playing a Slade as well here. He's a fucking amazing actor here.
I only got a minute to. So, but let's talk about the longevity of the influence of Powerpuff Girls versus the influence of Teen Titans. We already have superheroes, which are already an established element, right? So we already have Batman. We already have the Justice League. We already have all these things. What the Teen Titans is a spin-off of that for kids. Powerpuff Girls was an original show, taking three normal girls and giving them superpowers and allowing them to empower themselves. It's an original show that I think has really set the framework for future Hollywood and shaping the mind of future film people.
Powerpuff Girls and Teen Titans go on the same adventures. They all have to do the same thing over
okay,
and over
first
again.
Of all, has
when Mordecai and Rigby can just do different adventures each time.
And let's be honest here, the show has no set plot. It's random bullshit, really. While
poorly
Teen
animated.
Titans here has like each character arc here. You see the characters evolve
can,
as the show goes through
good
on.
For everyone.
Regular show
okay.
is nothing like that. It is mumble jumble garbage all cabaled together and saying, like, oh,
okay.
we're going to do this one, this one, this
we're
one.
We're going to go to our. We got to go. Okay. But. Wow.
This is going to be a great show.
Wow.
Today.
Oh, yeah. It is going to be a beautiful show today. Okay. We'll start with our 30-second conclusions and we'll go back the other way. So, Skylar, we'll start with you.
So like I said, Teen Titans deals with mature themes more so than these other two shows. It has relatable characters that anyone can possibly relate to. Each season focuses on a different character arc while also presenting more themes that can be considered questionable to some viewers. And again, this is why I'm saying that Teen Titans, the 2003 edition, is the best cartoon series to date.
Okay, Jake.
Powerpuff Girls has had the strongest influence on young minds than any of the shows that were placed before us. Teen Titans is a spinoff of already established superheroes. They're not doing anything original. It's some of the characters are over-sexualized, not as much influence as Powerpuff Girls. The regular show, poor animated, poor storyline, poor plot, poor show. Ding. Yeah.
And Haley.
All right, well, as I was trying to state, Teen Titans and Powerpuff Girls, they're doing the same thing. They're fighting crime, while Mordecai and Rigby each have their own unique adventures and all in the meantime are creating hilarious content for people of any age, really. And if we're going to talk about over-sexualizing, let's not forget the mayor's assistant. That's all I have to say.
Drop mic.
Facts to check, Vaughn.
Everything checked out, and we have some thoughts from the audience.
Okay. Oh, we have. Okay.
Whoa.
I figured we would.
All right. So, first of all, to counter Jake's point that Teen Titans has had no influence on the media, Cyborg, who has always been a member of the Teen Titans, is now a founding member of the Justice League, replacing or being added on to the original lineup. Furthermore, the mayor's assistant is incredibly, incredibly sexualized, and she was so sexualized, in fact, that they actually took her out of the reboot. Furthermore, Teen Titans has also received a reboot as well, as well as several animated movies in the DC animated universe of cinema.
Let's just don't talk about the reboot, okay? Let's just forget about it. Let's just forget about it. Let's move on.
Anybody have anything else they want to add?
May I rebuttal, good sir?
Okay.
Can I rebuttal to the audience?
Rebuttal to the audience? No. No.
Okay.
The powers that be are saying no.
The powers of
heart.
Fair enough.
Okay. Ooh, great arguments. I think this is the most passionate like our contestants have been, which I love that. Now I have to make tough decisions. And I thought it was going to be like which shirt and bow tie to wear. I thought that was going to be the hardest decision I had to make all day. Okay.
Good choice, by the way.
What? Thank you, Stuart.
Great choice.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just am. That's my only goal.
Okay. I'm going to give first place to Skylar, second place to Haley, third place to Jake. Why? I'm about to explain that. It's what I do. Okay. Skylar, I'm giving you first place because I feel like you did a great job of defending that the Teen Titans were not over-sexualized and that Raven and Starfire are both deep, complex characters who go through arcs of their own. And I think you've made it clear that they have had extended influence on like Cartoon Network shows and other forms of media afterwards. Haley, you had the awards, you have Mark Hamill to back it up, and you did point out that while Teen Titans and Powerpuff Girls are kind of formulaic in their plot structure, the regular show does try something new every time, and the degrees of success, while debatable by some, at least it shows that they're trying something new. Jake, they hit you hard with the mayor's assistant because it kind of tore down your entire point of empowering girls when the girls they're focusing on, yes, may be empowered, but then it'll cut to these segments where this dumpy little mayor gets to sexualize this beautiful, curvaceous.
I'll tell you this right now.
hated Cartoon Network. I don't think I watched any Cartoon Network at all, so that's fine. Perfectly fine. Nickelodeon. Whoa. All the way. All the way.
So, is that your so ha?
So, joke's on you,
yeah,
people.
Yeah, that random person in the audience for getting me. I wonder who that was. I don't know where he went, but... Oh, oh, there he is. Okay.
So, as it stands, Skylar gets first, Haley gets second, and Jake gets third. So, at the moment, Haley and Jake are trailing. And speaking of trailing, I think they know where they know where I'm going with this. How about we argue best movie trailer? Okay, this
oh my yeah. God.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're gonna
go home.
You're gonna be a great yeah. a great dad.
Oh, thank you.
I'm just telling
that's
you.
That's what I'm going for. This is the part where like the networks go to like the ding. So okay, we'll start with Jake, go to Haley, and then Skylar for this opening. So Jake, take us off.
Yeah, so I chose the Alien trailer. I wanted a trailer that didn't give away the big famous line of a movie, and I didn't want a trailer that basically told the entire story. Alien, watch it. If you get past the 80s sense of it, it is terrifying. If you can imagine watching TV and this trailer popping up, there's no spoken word in it. The only words is at the end, and it says, "No one in space, no one can hear you scream," which is terrifying. You don't know what's going on. They show snippets. You never see the alien. It is terrifying, and it did its job, which is to get people to go to the movies to watch this movie. So, Alien trailer, right there.
Gotcha. Okay, Haley, we'll go to you next.
All right, I chose Stanley Kubrick's The Shining for best movie trailer. Originally, this trailer was banned, but after Kubrick stated that rusty water was coming out of the elevators instead of blood, it was released and brought in a huge crowd. Combining the simple, eerie words and the magnificent score completely sold this trailer. It brings the audience in with the blood flowing from the elevators to the extent of not being able to look away. And I think that, of all things, should be the definition of the best movie trailer.
Hmm. And Skylar, we'll finish off with you.
Okay, so I went for a different route here, and I picked the best trailer to perhaps one of the worst movies of the two, Battle of Los Angeles. I am not going to lie, when I saw that trailer, I wanted to watch a movie, and I did, and I didn't like it, but the trailer is art. It shows you very little of what the movie is about, but gives you hints of what it is. If you know what Battle of Los Angeles is, it's basically the Battle of Los Angeles, where aliens come in. But the trailer depicts a different kind of alien invasion movie. It looked more realistic than previous alien invasion movies, while it's focusing more like a war movie. It is, like Saving Private Ryan, stuff like that. So with that, Battle of Los Angeles, the trailer itself, is the best trailer of all time.
Okay. Well, let's start our 5-minute forum then.
It's not. Here's the thing. Here's the thing.
If you watch
that trailer, it shows you pictures of aliens. Uh-huh. Then it says we were wrong. They're coming. And then it shows aliens showing up. Shows their ships. Shows them destroying the city. And then you see the soldiers going out shooting. Then you see the soldiers dying.
Yep.
That is the entire movie. I just watched the movie in 2 hours and 30 minutes, and I saved $8.50.
But we're talking
about
the trailer.
Looks like. Like one of the templates you would find on iMovie.
Yes, but
there's
no uniqueness to it
at all.
All right, here's the thing. This trailer here got me to buy tickets to watch it. And I bought tickets, but I freaking watched it. I hated it, but I loved the trailer of it. It's one of those movies where you can hooked up to a trailer, and you watch the movie, you're
wait,
like,
so you didn't watch
what
it in
the hell
movies?
Is it? And then,
what? Did you go to the movies and watch it?
No, I actually
well,
I saw.
It didn't do its job then, so it wasn't a good trailer.
Well,
I mean,
guess
it
what?
Was
if
a crappy trailer.
Guess what?
Told
I fucking went out and watched the movie. All right.
So let's go.
Well, here's the thing: you got Alien and Shining here. Both of these films are great, but you don't hear enough about the trailers. You don't hear jack shit about the trailers. You don't hear
do
great things about the movies here.
Well, let's talk about let's
right,
talk
so
about the Shining.
You
want to
talk
then.
About the movies?
Let's talk
you
about Shining.
You want to talk about a good movie here? You got Alien and Shining here. You don't hear anything about the trailer, so you don't hear the trailers about Battle of Los Angeles, and it's amazing.
I want a trailer,
but the trailer is awesome.
I want a trailer that doesn't give it away. And when I watched the trailer that I saw, it The Shining gave it away. I believe it even had the saying, the famous lines, "Here's Johnny," right? Am I correct? Did I watch the same trailer? Mm-hmm. That's it. That's the movie. Here's the thing.
They don't give you enough context that you get in the movie. So it literally puts this feeling of eeriness in it.
You have no clue
why he's saying, "Here's Johnny." He could literally be a housewife.
In the first 30 seconds, they say, there's this over voice. He says, "You know, the last caretaker went mad." Oh, so shit. He's a caretaker at a hotel and goes mad and kills his family with an axe. There's the movie. The trailer has ruined the movie.
But
ruin the movie.
It doesn't give you the context enough context.
But you'll hear nothing about the trailer about Alien here. You hear the trailer about Val Los Angeles, how being it's like the best trailer, but to the worst movie ever.
It's awfully long.
Oh, it is terrifying though.
Okay, mine is terrifying because you are just stuck on this one scene.
My trailer is freaking realistic as well.
Blood coming out of elevators instead of just watching a girl run down a hallway of a spaceship.
Stop. You are trashing the trailer when it does not need to be trashed. Because the trailer
isn't that great.
The trailer showed scenes with that beeping noise. No spoken word. You're watching TV in the 80s. You're watching TV, and all of a sudden, this trailer pops on. Wow. We have snippets of shots. We have the pod opening when everyone's waking up. You don't know what this is. This is the first movie of its kind. It's terrifying. What is going on?
After
a minute of hearing this
beeping noise, I'm going to turn it off.
Look at gross revenue. Five minutes long of her just running down a hallway and beeping going on.
And yours is an iMovie template. So, honestly, once I see the blood coming out of the elevators, I'm going to go buy tickets. I'm going
to
pre-order them.
Listen to me. The Alien trailer did its job. It fit the film because the film and the trailer were both that quick action, that quick sound, and the first of its kind. So that's what the movie was like, that's what the trailer was like, and it did enough to get me knowing that there's an alien, knowing that something's going to go wrong on this spacecraft, not a clue what's going to happen. In
Los Angeles, kind of depicts a realistic...
Alien shows up, aliens kill people, I see what the alien looks like, which is another bad thing. That's the thing with aliens, you don't even see the alien. They kill the soldiers fight, they lose, movie's over in 2 minutes and 35 seconds. The Shining, I know it's a hotel caretaker at a hotel.
You can read
and
that
he kills
in the
everybody.
Summary anywhere.
No, you okay. can't. You watch
it
the trailer and it ruins it. Alien
Here's
does not.
At all. You literally are watching Here's the trailer thing. And feeling uncomfortable the entire time.
Here's the thing. If you're going to watch a movie trailer, you're going to recognize one thing. Is the movie going to hook you up to it? You're going to like, are you going to watch it? I watched Battle of Los Angeles, not in the theaters, but I watched it. I watched it, and I watched it. I was disappointed a bit, but I remember the one thing. That trailer was awesome. Alien, I never watched a trailer of it. I watched a trailer. It was just okay, I guess. The movie is a ton better than that.
I'm not
Shining,
Battle of Los
what
Angeles
trailer?
On the top
what
of the
trailer?
List of movie trailers.
Here's Johnny. You ruined the movie, dude. I want my money back.
In space, no one can hear you scream.
Oh, don't even. Oh,
look
oh,
how stupid
no,
that
no, no,
sound.
No.
Okay. I feel like I should be like a 5-year-old kid, like huddled in a corner, and be like, I hate it when they fight. Like, I need an adult now. Like, yeah, it's like I want to live with grandma. But okay, let's do our 30-second conclusions. We'll start with Haley, go to Skylar, and then Jake.
Okay, well, I am still saying that The Shining is the best movie trailer because you are just sitting there watching blood flow through an elevator, which was not allowed at first. Kubrick had to convince them it was rusty water for it to be allowed, and it just makes you uncomfortable the entire time, and you don't have enough context to know what is actually happening in the movie. So it's the best. Just saying.
Battle of Los Angeles is a terrible movie, but the trailer wanted me to watch it. And that's all I'm going to say. The movie fooled me to thinking that this is going to be a realistic alien invasion movie, which it wasn't, but the trailer fooled me to believe that. And by that, if a trailer can fool you to thinking that it's going to be great, and the trailer did its job right there. So that's why I'm saying Battle of Los Angeles has the best movie trailer of all time.
And Jake, just because you're a fool doesn't mean that the trailer is good. Okay, look. I want a trailer that will, one, not spoil the movie, and two, give me enough to get me to the theaters, okay? Aliens trailer did an immaculate, a wonderful job at at terrifying viewers in the 80s. It had no spoken word. It had all the elements of the movie, and it got people to the box office, which is what a trailer needs to do. Gotcha.
Okay. Any facts to check, Vaughn?
No.
Wait. Like,
no.
We do have thoughts, though.
Oh, do have thoughts.
Dude, Force Awakens all the way.
I mean, I'm surprised that. Yeah,
get out of here, yeah, Stuart.
No. That was more of a homage thing, okay, right? Let's be honest with you. That was just a homage.
Okay. Okay. Time. I'm going to give first place to Jake, second place to Haley, third place to Sky. Right?
Okay. Okay. I accept it.
So, Jake, I think you did a great job of painting the trailer that tantalizes people to come into the office or come into the theater without giving away like any of its plot or really anything. It just it sets the mood, it sets the atmosphere, and it forces the audience to ask questions. And you do have the box office revenue and the acclaim to back that up. Haley, I think yours is also a great trailer. I think, but I think Jake hit you a little hard there where it's like the here's Johnny part and like the last caretaker was murdered. It kind of, I begin to put like the dots in my head. It's like, even if it's a great movie, I kind of go in knowing what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. Skylar, they hit you hard.
Oh, they did.
they really rammed you.
They hit me harder than the critics in Valve Los Angeles.
And I, in my mind, a good trailer should reflect what the movie is about, not trick people into going to see the movie. A trailer should be a taste, not like the Bean Boozled beans of a jelly. Oh, I like that. Somebody write that down. I'm copywriting that.
Got it.
Actually, I can't copyright that. Bean Boozled is already copyrighted. Darn it. Okay. But so while the trailer may have led you to believe one thing, I feel like it did not do its job in accurately portraying what the movie is about. So for this round, Jake gets first place, Haley gets second, Skylar gets third. And wow, guys, that was a really heated fight. It's almost like there's a war going on in here, which is why I think we should go to best war movie. And who hasn't started? Jake, you haven't started yet. In intros? Yes, he did. Okay, Skylar hasn't started in intros. So we'll start with Skylar for intros.
Oh, okay. All right, so this is a newcomer here. So the best war movie I picked was Dunkirk. This movie has been pumped up for the summer block office. And admittedly, the summer films didn't do so great, but this film is one of my favorite films of this year so far. It shown a different side of war that we haven't seen before, and it's the psychological effect. Sometimes when you're in war, you don't see the enemy here, and which this movie perfectly captures it. You don't know when the enemy's going to strike. You don't know if you're going to live or not. The last instinct you have with you is survive. And this is what the movie is all about. It's about survival. It's about living, coming back home, see your family. And you're so close to home, but it is just miles away from where you are and making that last stand that survive. And that's why I think Dunkirk is the best war movie.
Hmm. Okay, we'll go with Haley next.
Okay. I chose the 1979 Francis Ford Coppola film, Apocalypse Now, as the best war movie. Winning two Oscars and having a huge success after its long-awaited release was only some of the many accomplishments conquered by Apocalypse Now. It includes great acting by those such as Marlon Brando, Martin Sheen, and Robert Duvall. And by delving into the psychological aspects of war, it differs greatly from other war films. Not to mention it focuses on Vietnam War, which is not always highly focused on as others in film. Combining all of these aspects ultimately makes Apocalypse Now the best war film.
Ooh. And we'll finish off with Jake.
Saving Private Ryan, hands down. It doesn't really even need an intro, but I'll give it one anyways. It showed the realism of World War II. It showed the patriotic effect of World War II. It showed it had a very dynamic plot. It had incredible acting. I wish I put the numbers down for the number of awards it won. Vaughn's going to look it up. It won a ton of awards, probably. It's phenomenal. better than these two movies, hands down, not even in the same ballpark. Saving Private Ryan is strictly the best. I'll save the rest of the 20 seconds that are left for you.
Oh, for me? Okay, well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, we'll go straight into our five-minute forum.
I would just like to start by saying Saving Private Ryan is not better than the other two. Because
wrong,
if we're
going
to go with Rotten Tomatoes scores, I have a 98% next to 92 for both of yours.
Rotten Tomatoes, what's the point of that?
I'm just going off of some critics here.
I don't care about critics. Cause I care about I'm the everyday consumer of movies. And let's talk about Apocalypse Now. I watched it today. Apocalypse Now today. Garbage. Did not like it. Here's why. I don't know if you can classify it as a strong enough war movie. It could be an adventure movie with war as a background. It's based off of a book, and the book is Into the Heart of Darkness, and it's all about how going into the jungle and getting back to your savage roots, right? Well, that plot line can be taken out and put into, say, an Indiana Jones or an adventure movie or any other movie. War, there really was not much war. I don't even think Martin Sheen, I forget the name of him.
Martin Sheen
didn't, the character, but I don't even think he fired his weapon. There was no war scenes. When I think of a war film, I think of a film that is realistic. I think of a film that shows you what war was like during that time.
But it's like the I said, it's
scene,
focusing
on second,
psychological
on,
effects.
I know, one second. The D-Day invasion scene showed D-Day in a way that everyone can understand, and everyone can gawk at, and everyone can, wow, this is what it was like. I'm proud to be an American. The Apocalypse Now was made, it was completely fantasy. We had savages fighting with sticks, and then we had this crazy guy, and he was, and Martin Sheen dancing, he's doing the weird thing. That's so much fantasy. It was an embarrassment to the soldiers that fought in that war. If I was a soldier in Vietnam, I would be ashamed of that movie. On top of the highly racist nature and undertone of the Vietnamese and Southern Asian cultures that did with savagery. Go ahead. That's fine. That's all I need.
All right. Okay. Let's talk about Saving Private Ryan here for a sec here.
I can't.
The first 20 minutes is what the whole film is all about. That's the reason why you're paying your tickets there. The rest of the film is boring. It's by the books,
God.
And it's just straightforward. It's nonsensical. It's
Saving
Private
Ryan has
far from being believable.
Quick.
All right.
And then it's
are you
done.
Watching
the first
the movie?
20 minutes?
Yes.
Okay,
you're not
okay,
watching.
Okay, I'll give it to this. The 20 minutes, phenomenal, 10 out of 10. But the rest of the movie, we're talking about a 2 hour long here movie here. All right. The first 20 minutes movie is great. But the rest of it is slow. It is boring, and it's like almost dramatic here, and it takes away the realism here. Whereas Dunkirk
was terrible. It had three different zones, right? Night, dark, day. Who knew what was going on? No centralized.
It tells
character.
You at the beginning of the movie here. It says at the beginning here.
There was no plot. It was poorly told. It was over nothing. People standing on a beach. It was garbage.
Look at whatever
you want to look at. It was garbage.
Okay.
I'm going to move on to Apocalypse Now because the
no,
only
no,
thing
here's
worthy
the thing.
Enough
to talk about garbage
all
here.
All
Dunkirk here shows
a
different size of war
these
here.
These are
the psychological
showing why
here,
this is
all right?
so different from other
yeah,
war
it did.
Films.
You don't see
you may not
here.
See people it's firing their guns, but you're seeing all of these crazy
now
things happening
was not
because
real.
Of the psychological
it wasn't
effects
realistic.
From
you
war.
Look, you see
was
war
not
as
realistic.
The combat of it. You don't see the psychological of the
but
effects
that's
here.
Exactly
soldiers
what
come home with PTSD
in
here.
Part
then
of
Dunkirk
make
here.
A movie like
Dunkirk
American
here.
Sniper. Make a movie like the
American
new one
Sniper was absolute
for,
shit.
Thank you for
everything
your service.
Was shit.
That's a movie that for PTSD.
Yeah, here's the thing here.
What we don't talk about. All we see are the guns, and all we see are the combat, but we aren't thinking about what is in everybody's head.
But that's made up. That's never happened. I've never seen a soldier go crazy with savages, hijack
that's
a Viet Cong
war
here,
dance around naked.
And
that's never
thing.
Happened.
It
I want to be
in Apocalypse
film.
Now.
I
and here's the
yeah,
thing. Here's
fake,
the thing.
In a crappy fake film. Hold on.
Okay.
I'm going to save Private Ryan. Saving Private Ryan. Here we go.
The first 20 minutes is great. The rest of
the
you could just forget
okay?
it all. All right.
These are film people. We have the hook. It brings people in. Then we talk about the story. The story shows
it
symbolizes it
is boring.
The war.
The story is boring.
The whole reason that they went after and risked everything
it's so
for
boring.
For Private
20 minutes
Ryan
are great.
Is because
that's about it.
Is because
Dunkirk
Europe
shows three different sides of the war here.
Come on, hold on. It's because Europe. Is because Europe was hurting.
He can't handle
right?
the heat.
Europe was hurting, and so we needed to go in and save Europe. We'll sacrifice anything there is for Europe, and that's what we were doing with the Ryan, with the Ryan family.
Yeah,
is
They've sacrificed so much.
Yeah,
we're going to give everything we have to save you. Go home, Ryan. We've saved you now. That's an Americana film. That's a historic film. That's a realistic film.
It's and it's also not historically accurate enough for the D-Day invasion here. Canada,
yes,
Britain, United States. The film of Saving Private Ryan only showed the American side of it. Dunkirk was all about the Great Britons here. I mean, it's a side of war
so
we have never seen before. It was a story that no one has heard about until now by Christopher Nolan here.
Okay. Wow. I like that movie. I like the movie.
No, that's you made that extremely clear. No. Okay. We'll do 30-second conclusions with who have I not started with conclusion? Who hasn't started a conclusion? Has everyone started
both
a
conclusion? Both of them. I started both conclusions. I thought.
Are we gonna argue about the conclusions now? Let's do it.
Okay. No. We'll start conclusions with Jacob.
Okay. Saving Private Ryan is a realistic war film, and then when I think of a war film, I think of a film that shows what it was like during that time. Dunkirk had no structured plot line. It had no centralized character. It had a terrible story, and I think it was already been done. Apocalypse Now was too far-fetched. It was too made up, and it didn't have anything really to do with war. It had to do with the jungle and getting back to your savage roots. Saving Private Ryan is a wonderful film and is the best war movie of all time.
Okay, we'll go to Skylar next.
Dunkirk explores a different side of war, and it tells a different story of World War II. D-Day has been talked about all the time here. It has been talked about in video games, it has been talked about in TV shows, and it has been talked about movies countless of times here. Dunkirk shows something different here, and that audience, including myself, has never seen before. We saw three different sides of war. We saw the troops, the Navy, and we had the Air Force here. And by the way, most of the film was done in practical effects here. All right? And that's the reason why Dunkirk is the best war movie of all time.
Okay, and Haley.
So Apocalypse Now is the best war film of all time. And I'm just going to tell you, plot-wise, Dunkirk has none. Your climax is too fast. Mine has the perfect plot line that we all want in a war film. And we are seeing the psychological effects that we are not shown in everyday life so that we can learn a little bit about something new and not just see men shooting each other. Thank you.
Okay. Facts to check, Vaughn.
Okay, so Haley, how many Oscars did you say it won?
I didn't.
Okay, never mind. So, Jake, you're correct. Saving Private Ryan did win awards. Not a ton of awards, though. It didn't
That's
win 2000, only 74.
Won some. only 74 awards.
Well,
tons of measurements.
Yeah. And then you said Dunkirk was garbage. Check whatever you want. So I checked a few things. So it has an 8.3 on IMDb, a 92% on Rotten Tomatoes, and a 94 on Metacritic. So take that as you will. And then we have some thoughts from the audience.
Oh, I'm sure we do.
Hi. Okay, so I just wanted to mention a couple things about Apocalypse Now. Okay. First off, not to attack you because I feel like you kind of got the short end of the stick here, but when you mentioned at the beginning how there's not a lot of films set in Vietnam, I got on Wikipedia and just within 30 seconds I found 95 separate films and 36 documentaries that say otherwise. I can show Vaughn that in a second, but I do want to kind of defend you here when they were really beating you up over like the racism and the kind of themes that it explores in there. I think it's important and it should be thrown out there since nobody mentioned this, that Heart of Darkness, Apocalypse Now is actually a contemporary reimagining of the book Heart of Darkness, which in and of itself like explored the themes of like the darkness that hides within mankind's heart and that sort of thing. And it was written when the Congo was being colonialized by the Dutch and whatnot, talking about the savagery or the perceived savagery that existed in there. So I just want to kind of throw that out there in defense of her since I feel like she kind of got talked over in the middle of all that.
Thank you.
All right, so I'm a history minor with a specialty in
with a specialty in
the Second World War. Dunkirk, you mentioned that it's all about the British. Dunkirk also had a huge French play in that as well, and the French are hardly featured. So your point with Saving Private Ryan's kind of moot. The other thing too is when you compare the three films to their historical accuracy. I think Saving Private Ryan is considered by most historians to be the closest to World War II. That being said, Dunkirk is extremely accurate to the time. And there really wasn't much focus on the Navy. It was more like evacuation ships, which are civilians, not really the Navy. It's a me thing.
Not the Navy.
So we're doing a lot of crew thoughts, so I'll make this quick. I know, Jake, you said something about the story of Apocalypse Now could be taken as an adventure. So what if I told you a story about a group of guys that went on a journey to find this other guy to bring him back home?
Yeah.
That sounds awfully like an adventure to me.
Well, yeah, right. But here's the thing. They didn't
That's
get,
all my thoughts
They
are.
Didn't turn into these savage monsters,
Okay. So I have to make a decision. Yeah, this is fun. My job is hard. That's good. Okay. None of you know where I live, right?
No, I do.
I can find out.
Okay, calling the movers tomorrow. Okay. I'm gonna give first place to Jacob. Giving second place to Haley, third place to Skylar.
What?
That's math.
I thought I put a good fight.
No, you all put in an excellent fight, and like.
I thought it was second place worthy right there. well, you better move out quickly, son.
I know. Yeah.
Segue, Mark.
Okay, so Jacob, I'm giving you Saving Private Ryan. I'm giving you first place because you did well to defend that it does have a story after the invading of Normandy scene. It does have a story that kind of parallels what America was going through in World War II, which I thought was great. Nick, history minor does count for something, I guess, in saying that it does, in saying that it is probably the most historically accurate war film. So I think Skylar and Haley did make some good blows against you, but you know, and I'm probably gonna sleep on this and like have a recurring nightmare or something about this, but. As it stands right now, you get first place. Haley, I'm giving you second place because I think you did a great job showing that Apocalypse Now shows the unexplored side of war, the psychological effects, that war isn't all about the violence and the bloodshed. It's also about what occurs in the mind. And
the weird naked dancing people.
And that's what's occurring in the mind.
Oh, look at me. It was weird.
I think you were so close. But Hunter's point that it was an adaptation of a novel that wasn't about the Vietnam War kind of put some context in there that made me give you second place. And then Skylar, I think Dunkirk is a great movie. I do.
It is.
It is a great movie. The reason I'm giving you third place is because, as Nick said, it didn't really focus on the French aspect. It is historically accurate from the terms of the British perspective, and it has a very interesting narrative. But all in all, I don't know if I would call it so much a war movie, since it is more of like an evacuation operation rather than a direct combat situation. So yeah, you know, I'm probably gonna end up regretting this decision. You know, and I usually don't regret my decisions. I'm a theater major, for heaven's sakes, you know, for whatever that counts, whatever that's worth. But as it stands for this round, Jacob first place, Haley second, Skylar third. So I don't know. I don't think I mentioned this. Did I mention the double point system we have for the fourth question? So for the fourth question, all the point values are doubled. That way it remains anyone's game till the very end. So now that I have given my spiel. Yeah.
Oh, God, there we go.
Yeah. How about, oh, thank you. Oh. Now that I've given my spiel, how about you guys give me your best Steven Spielberg movie?
There's the door over there?
Yeah, the door, and I'm, yeah.
It's the last one, so.
So, we'll start, who hasn't started yet? Have you all started?
Yeah.
Dark confounded.
How about you start?
Hey, how about I start? Yeah, I don't know what. We'll start with Skylar.
All right, so my film I picked for best Steven Spielberg film is The Schindler's List. This is by far his most darkest, most raw, and most personal film he has made to this date. Previous Steven Spielberg movies show like the softer side, like the innocence, pure and like captivating family to action adventure film, while this one explores a darker side of humanity that is often looked away. The Schindler's List shows violence, it shows the darker side of humanity, and it shows one man's struggle to become a savior to a people that his country despise. And it's by that reason alone, Schindler's List is Steven Spielberg's greatest work of all time.
Okay, we'll just move right along the line. Jacob?
I went with Raiders of the Lost Ark. Here's why. I usually can just say that one of them is garbage and we move on, but I can't here because they're all great movies. So she's going to talk about her movie here in a second. But here's why Raiders of the Lost Ark is better than the other two. The biggest thing is it's a timeless classic. Doesn't matter how young or old you become, you can always pop in Raiders of the Lost Ark. It is a timeless classic that the other two just simply don't have. It has an exciting plot, very up and down plot, whereas the other two have a very flat, static plot. And then the dynamic character of Indiana Jones is just simply, he has everything. He's sexy, he's funny, he's smart, he's brave, he has everything that their characters just don't have. But again, they're great movies. Spielberg, don't hate me. They are good movies, but mine's just better.
And Haley.
All right, I'm going to get real serious. Oh. 2 hours and 10 minutes of pure thrill, the 1975 film Jaws is hands down the best Steven Spielberg movie ever created. Starting at a budget of $4 million, Spielberg was quickly hated after making it for $9 million. He was promised never to get a job again until Jaws broke $100 million at the U.S. box office, which was the first film to ever do so. Between the influence it had on future films and the utter terror it put in audiences of what lives beneath the ocean, Jaws is a classic that can be recognized by the haunting score by John Williams or the famous quote that we all know and love. So it's the best.
Okay. Well, let's not mince any words. Let's just get straight into it.
Okay, you want to talk about flat characters here? Oscar Schindler is a real character here. He had everything to begin with, and he risked it all to save Jews here who are being thrown into concentration camps and be killed like cattle. He has risked everything to save these people here. And you're talking about a flat character here? Indiana Jones is a basic character here that's been copied at like dozens of times now. He is literally a carbon copy of James Bond here.
Well, he's copied.
That's who he is. But he's just a different version of James Bond, whereas Oscar Schindler is his whole
Schindler's
man.
Schindler's List is Spielberg's best work of art, not his best movie, okay?
Yes,
Here's why. It is, only for a specific group of audience members. It is a black and white film noir, 3 hours and 15 minutes, very slow dialogue is based in that time, and it can really only be, if you like black and white movies, you can get into Schindler's List, but with Raiders of the Lost Ark, doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter how old you become, how old that movie is, it's something you can always watch. Schindler's List, although a very great movie, a very great character, sure, he's a very flat character, not because he's bad or anything, but because that's the style of movie that he chose. He chose a very flat movie just because that's the style and that worked for the movie,
all right,
but not as his best.
I'm just going to break this to you both
best.
Right now. If Jaws hadn't done such a great job, if he hadn't done a great job making that movie, neither of those two movies would be made.
But here's the thing. Jaws is his first movie, and technically speaking, it is his worst movie to date. You're talking about a first movie here. You can't put it the same standard with Schindler's List and Indiana Jones. The first work of anything you do is the worst that you can make.
Created.
Yeah,
well,
but it's also not that great here. They're having some technical shorts difficulty with it.
At its time, yes, it was.
The technical difficulty added to the terror put in the audience.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a second. Well, the technical aspect of the shark was fine during that time, but here's the thing. It's not a timeless piece because it's tough to watch now. In this era of CGI, and as we, your child will have a tough time getting through Jaws because Jaws is a very flat movie.
I have to disagree.
It's a very slow movie.
It's also his first film.
But now, Raiders of the Lost Ark, the last scene is a little cheesy, and I'll give you that, it's still believable just because of the way that they filmed it with a lot of live action shots, a lot of live action props, those types of things. The way that they filmed it, it's a timeless piece, whereas Jaws didn't. And Jaws, a lot of sharks were murdered, brutally killed, and pushed to extinction because of the movie.
They used an animatronic shark.
Well, I know, but afterwards, yeah, but afterwards, it had this really kind of a negative effect on actual sharks. I mean, sharks were murdered and killed. And so, if you think about the effects of the movie, I think Raiders of the Lost Ark should be something you should hang your hat on. I'm surprised E.T. is not thrown in here either. I don't know when was E.T. made in comparison.
Look here.
Jaws. I don't know.
Schindler's List. All right. Here we go. Schindler's List on IMDb, it is ranked number 6 out of 250 films. That is the highest movie ranking than either YouTube films.
Number 9
on the AF American Film Institute's Greatest American Movies. Number 9 out of 100 films here.
It's only for a specific group. You have to have 3 hours and 15 minutes of black and white movie and be in for it. Raiders of the Lost Ark, you can watch it day in, day out.
All right, here we go. Spielberg here refused to be paid for this movie when he was making it. Instead, he donated all to the Shoah Foundation, which is the Holocaust Holocaust Museum
here.
Sounds
like a great guy.
Schindler's List is also his first movie to win Best Picture and Best Director here. Did any of your films win Best Picture or Best Director in the Oscars? They didn't.
I don't
Schindler's
care
List
about
is the first
the
film
of a
to
movie.
Win his
I
best picture
the
and best
the
director here.
Better.
It is
the
also
Jaws
the highest grossing black and white film of all time.
The CGI has nothing to do with it because when you see the Jaws sequels, they eventually got better with CGI, but it just didn't look good because
it was such a classic.
Today,
the same thing can be said with Raiders of the Lost Ark.
CGI would ruin it.
It is cheesy.
Hold on one second. The Raiders of the Lost Ark, the Super character cheesy. That Harrison Ford plays is a character that is still used. You can still watch, it's Halloween time. You can watch people still dress up as Indiana Jones. He's a lovable character because he's so dynamic. Nobody can remember the characters from Jaws except
for
the shark.
And he's also a rip-off of James Bond.
No, he's not. Look, he's a dynamic
character.
You have
a good-looking guy going on an adventure
that's
picking up good-looking women here.
The plot line for you guys are so flat.
Yeah, the plot line for mine is realistic, and
it's
based on a true scenario here. Schindler's List is about a man risking all to save the people that his country despised.
No, it's not.
Let's see, we'll do 30-second conclusions. We'll start with Haley, and then... Oh, no, we start with you, like, a lot.
I don't care.
I mean, we'll start with Haley again, and we'll just go the other way.
Jaws is still the best Spielberg film. I'm saying the sequels that were made to Jaws, they originally used CGI, and it did not look as good as the original. So it is a timeless piece that can be watched by anyone, anytime. And like I said, if Spielberg had not made this film the way that he did... Under the circumstances, he would not have been able to make any of the other films today.
Okay. Go to Jake. It doesn't matter whether it was first or not. That doesn't matter. I talk about the longevity of the piece, and you can still watch Raiders of the Lost Ark. The sequels were better than any sequels from Jaws. The plot line of Raiders of the Lost Ark goes up and down. We have a dynamic character who has all these different elements. He's lovable. You can hate him. You can find him sexy. You can find him exciting. But at the end of the day, Raiders of the Lost Ark is a timeless piece that really is something that Spielberg can hang his hat on rather than a really boring, flat movies like Schindler's List, which is 3 hours and 15 minutes, or Jaws, which is really flat and sharks.
And go to Skype.
All right.
You have Jaws. It's Spielberg's first movie, and it's technically speaking his worst movie. You have Indiana Jones, who is basically a copycat of James Bond here. Schindler's List is his first film to have won an Oscar for Best Picture and Best Director. He has been recognized by the Academy, and Schindler's List has been declared as his greatest work to date. It's raw, it's powerful, and it's motivating, it's captivating, and it shows the human spirit, and sometimes in a very, very dark, real world.
Any facts to check, Vaughn?
Just one. Jaws was not his first movie. It wasn't his first theatrical release
either. Wait, was it the truck one?
No, that was the direct to TV.
1941 actually came after Jaws.
And I did not say what? Jaws was his first.
And Amblin was his first theatrical release in 1968.
There's a truck one. Never mind. Sorry, I'm hung up on this truck one. Never mind. Anyone have things to say? Thoughts to express?
Yeah, I'm just kind of wanting to throw this out there. I'm not entirely sure if it's fair to compare apples to oranges, which is why I just kind of want to throw out there that if you want to talk about flat plot lines about an actual historical event, or the fact that it's a very timeless piece, and yeah, I mean, I think there's merit to that. I agree with it. But at the same time, we're talking about one of the most important movies about one of the most terrible tragedies that humanity has ever inflicted upon itself. I just think that that's not really a fair comparison, just to be honest.
I was waiting for Skyler to pull the Oscar card. So I think with that being the case, I think he kind of wins it. And then, Jake, you were winning it for a while, but then it got almost to the point where you're starting to argue too much for the character, not the film.
Well, the character is the film.
Yeah, Indiana you could Jones say that. I mean, it's called Raiders of the Lost Ark. It's not called Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark. That was after. And so I think with the attacks that they had against Indiana Jones, unintentionally against the movie, I think still kind of float. So, but those are my thoughts.
Okay. I make that noise so you know I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. That's my thinking noise. Every episode, if I have to, it's a new panel of fighters, so I'm gonna make that joke. Of course, I guess it's probably the same audience members, so maybe I should change that. Maybe I'll just tell my fighters now. It's like, if you want to know why I make that noise, watch last episode, or any episode before that. Anywho, I'm gonna cut the tension. First place goes to Skylar. Second place, Haley. Third place, Skylar. I gave you first place. I think we all know why I gave you Schindler's List is a beautiful film. I mean, a historically significant film. Oscar Schindler is a dynamic character because at first he goes into it just wanting to make money, basically war profiteering, and then he ends up having a change of heart and wanting to save these people. And there's just a lot of depth, a lot of painful historical accuracy to that. You mentioned it was an AFI number six on AFI, I think.
No, it's number six on IMDb and number nine on AFI.
Fine. So, yeah, you get first place for that. Haley, I'm going to give you second place because I think you made a good point that this film really showcased what Spielberg could do. And I'm going to actually reference back to Jake's earlier argument in the trailer about how, like, one of the scariest part of Alien was we never actually saw the alien. And I think one of the scariest part of Jaws is you never really see the shark that much, you know. And when you do see it, it's quick, and it doesn't linger. And so I think it's that kind of dread of, like, not knowing what's there. And Jaws did invent the summer blockbuster as we know it today. And I'm going to give you third place because I think you're just kind of hanging too much on the character. Indiana Jones, you said he's handsome and sexy and smart and
he's
dynamic.
The movie, though. Indiana Jones is Indiana Jones because of Indiana Jones.
But he's everything you said he was, and that's the problem. He doesn't need to change. He's got it all. He's smart. He's tough.
Oh, you're overlooking the movie, my friend.
James Bond. But now you're saying that I'm overlooking the movie, but you're saying the character is the movie, and I'm focusing on the character.
We're stuck in a paradox.
So, yeah. So I think through the transitive property. And Skyler made a good point. I mean, he's basically our American James Bond of the cool, suave hero archetype that everybody wants to be.
James Bond is not he's not an archaeologist.
He's not. And so I feel like while Indiana Jones is a fun movie, it's you can find the type of adventure and character in other movies as well.
So
it's
you all are going to watch Schindler's List 3 hours 15 minutes on Netflix. It's on there if you're going to stick through it.
Oh.
It's
good.
It is. No,
I guess
movie.
We're all
no,
going
it is.
We're
going to
all
good.
Go home and have a Schindler's List cry party like later.
They are
so
good movies.
My dad's going to hate me
so,
for being Raiders of the Lost Ark right now.
So, just to recap, first place Skylar, second place Haley, third place Jake. What does that leave our score?
That leaves Skylar in first with 11 points. Haley in second with 10 points. Also to point out, she got second place in every single round. That's
yeah,
interesting.
I get
and Jake in third with 9 points.
9 points.
Okay. Well, ouch. Don't have to. I had some good. Good job. This was a great fight. Like, I'm like questioning decisions I've made, and I haven't done that since ever. So, wow. So thank you all. Thank you, Haley, Jake, and Skylar, for a great, great fight. If you have any questions or certain topics you want us to debate, leave us a comment or tell us on our website. And remember to hit that subscribe and like button if you like today's fight. Share us on social media. I'm Mark Rollins, and this is...